All right, gentlemen, let's give this another try. We're heading into week 7 of the NFL slate. I've had some thoughts. Question myself about how much time I spend going through lines and trying to figure out how to come up with the best 5 picks every week. And I'll start here. Essentially, we're playing for $500 over a 17-week slate. So that means we're playing for $29.41 every week. Let that set in for 1 second. Now, I don't know how much time you gentlemen spend going through lines, but I spend, a significant amount of time. Like, I kind of have a routine every week right now. You know, it's Thursday. I write down all the games, and I pick the lines without knowing what the lines are. And then I write down the lines, what the lines actually are, and figure out where I think value is. And then, you know, Friday I listen to a podcast when I get home about, you know, the actual betting lines and where there's advantages. And then I do that again on Saturday. And when I get home on Saturday night, I break it out and I write out all my notes. And then I go through and I dig through. And, we're talking 5-6 hours a week for a $29.41 a week competition. And I love it. This is great. Means that I'm not dead in my heart, that winning means something to me. And that inspired me this week. So, bounce back week for me coming up. We'll do the normal here. We'll do some good picks, bad picks. Good picks, all of us had good picks. Lions, good pick last week. Got, any home, Detroit stuff out of our mind. And just went ahead, pulled the trigger on the Lions. Game never in doubt. Good job, us. Dave, Joe, Steelers, good pick, never in doubt. Mike, Niners, on the right side of the sharp money last week. Me, on the wrong side of the sharp money on that game. Took the Rams. Jared Goff, you're dead to me. I'll just use you as a Goff joke from now on. Really, bad pick ever to pick against the Bears? I don't know. I'll get into it a little bit more later, but I think a lot of us just have groupthink when it comes to the Bears lately, and lately this season, the entire season. We have groupthink. We think the Bears are bad and overrated. Their record isn't indicative of a 5-1 team, but they are 5-1, and as Marvin Lewis said, you are what your record says. I don't know. One of the head coaches said that at some point. Let's see here. Let's go to the teaser blow up of the week this week. I would say that the Saints, don't put the Saints in the teaser this week, guys. That game's going to be a lot closer than I think a lot of us would anticipate. I would not trust the Saints in the teaser. The analytics have gone too far in some of the decisions that the coaches are making. I don't understand why the Texans would go for 2 to try and go up 9. I understand they're saying they are ending the game, but, you know, all the scenarios that would have to play out for you to lose the game after that are very significant. Not that an extra point is a gimme anymore, but you go up 8 with a minute 20 to go, that means that your opponent has to drive the length of the field, score a touchdown, and then get a 2-point conversion. And then on top of it all, you have to lose in overtime. The Texans managed to do it anyway, so, I guess, whatever. But I think going up 8 is a good thing. But apparently, all the gurus out there, it's not a good thing. You should go up 9 late in the game. Riverboat Ron, I think he was going for 2 there just to make sure he didn't have to stay in New York any longer. And, maybe they're tanking for Trevor right now anyways, and they didn't really want to get a win last week. And then a few weeks ago, that Minnesota-Seattle game, I don't really know if I touched on that, but, going for 2 up, or not going for 2, but going for a first down up 5 when you have a gimme field goal and go up 8, that's a whole other thing, too. There's a lot of things that, I don't know if analytics take into account the fact that, if we go for it here on 4th down and we miss it, and these things happen, but let's just say we kick the field goal. They take into account that it takes, 6 seconds come off the clock when you kick a field goal, And then do they take into account that another, I don't know, 8 seconds come off the clock when you kick the ball off? I don't know if they do, whatever. And then really quickly, like, it's, I like to do something fun. It's political season, you know, we get to do this, you know, only so many times in our life. And I thought it'd be fun to mention that Mike should run for Congress. Mike, you are my top one pick out of the four of us to run for Congress. You got the personality, the beautiful wife, the children, the family, all that stuff. I think you'd get up on a debate stage and just charm the pants off the voters. I would put myself at number two. My only pullback on myself is that there's some skeletons in the closet. And, I mean, you'd have the other side, like, they wouldn't have to dig too deep. And, you know, they'd see some stuff. And then I'd, you know, have to, you know, answer those questions. And I just wouldn't want to do that. Dave, I don't know. I just think there'd be a lot of things that you'd be like, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. You know, you wouldn't appeal to the other side ever and say, oh, well, I feel for this. You wouldn't feel for people. And Joe, I would put you at the bottom of this political list because I just think that there'd be a lot of fuck yous when it would come to somebody trying to make a point on the other side. You know, it's not enough. I know you, and I think there'd be a lot of, no, that didn't make any sense, so fuck off, coming out of your mouth. So, guys, let's get into it. Week 7 of the NFL slate. We're going to do the don't. We'll do the don'ts, and then we do the do's. We'll go out to Los Angeles for the Chargers. We're hosting the Jacksonville Jaguars. Jags catching a solid 7.5 all week, 54% of the bets, 53% of the money on the Chargers. I'd lean Chargers here, Chargers off a bye. Jacksonville was just, I mean, I said it at the beginning of the season, they had a couple of, like, they had a positive outcome, kept that Titans game close, and Jags got a little bit of love, and I don't know. I just think here, if I didn't have to lay the 7.5, I would definitely go Chargers here. I have, you know, Justin Herbert love all over the place. I love Keenan Allen coming back to the lineup this week, fully healthy. I think that the Chargers are going to have a game plan here. Go deep, go long, get the ball to Keenan, and I just hate laying the hook there. So go Chargers. Let's go out to Las Vegas where the Raiders are hosting the Buccaneers. Bucks opened up, laying 2.5 out to 4. Vegas catching a good percent of the money here, and I think this would be an ultimate, like, sell spot on the Bucks. You know, coming off that huge win against Green Bay, very convincing win last week, and it almost makes you forget the fact that the last time we saw the Raiders on the field, they beat the Kansas City Chiefs. So I think you lose, you know, you gain some value there going Raiders here because everybody forgot that. Yeah. We're off a bye with the Raiders, and they beat the Chiefs 2 weeks ago just like one of the most shocking outcomes of the season. So I think the Raiders are getting over that 3 points. I like it. I would lean Raiders here, but I stay away. I'm just not – I've seen a lot of good and a lot of bad out of the Bucs. You know, the penalties with the Bucs this year. Last week, no penalties, no yardage. 2 weeks ago, 11 penalties, you know, so I don't know what I'm going to get, so I just stay away. It's a little too volatile for me there. Oh, boy. Let's go to my girl. Atlanta Falcons. Hosting the Detroit Lions. Lions catching 2.5, opened up as 2-point dogs. Falcons catching 50% of that, 34% of the money. And I think that if we were outside of Detroit and we hadn't had so much scorn from the Lions, I think we could see the Lions as a value here this week, and I don't blame you if you go Lions here. I lean Lions. I stay away only because I'm a Lions fan. I've seen this play out over and over and over again over 40 years of my life. The Lions have had double-digit leads in every game this year. So I wanted to play Lions here, but then I play it out in my head, and I go, okay, so cool. Lions are going to be up double digits. What'll happen? The Falcons start passing. Falcons start passing against that piss poor Lions secondary and definitely get back in the game. So, I mean, this is a game where I see us late third, early fourth. Lions are up 7 to 10 points, and we're reverse engineering the game to figure out how the Falcons are going to win. So I think my girl will come back, beat the Lions this week. But, I mean, I would lean Lions here. I think there's value there in the Lions if you're outside of Detroit. If you live in Detroit, you bet on the Lions. Good on you. And he's just stone cold balls. Let's go down to the desert. Cardinals hosting the Seahawks this week. Seahawks laying 3. Opened up as 3.5-point favorites with a bunch of money on the cards. 63% of the bets, 83% of the money on the Cardinals. I don't really understand why. I don't really like flying into all that sharp money. I would like to lean Seattle here. I think Seattle is definitely a better team, better quarterback. I dug and I found some numbers here that are kind of disturbing on the Seattle side. Seattle with Pete Carroll, 5-10-1 against the spread as divisional road favorites. Kingsbury, 10-4-2 against the spread as a dog. So that alone, like, just keeps me off it there. Take Seattle, lay the 3 here, though. I think it's good if you do that. Let's go out to Houston, where the 1-5 Texans are hosting the 4-1 Green Bay Packers. Line opened up. Green Bay laying 3. We're out to 3.5. 37%, but only 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4% of the money on the Houston Texans. That's a lot of money on the Packers. And I mean, I know it passes that, you know, that critical control point of 3, but I honestly would lean Green Bay here, and I would take Green Bay if this number had gotten out to like 4.5, 5, 5.5, 6. That number not moving to me is just scary. So this is scared money here, not playing the Packers, just leaning the Packers. Aaron Rodgers, 40-21-1 against the spread after against the spread loss. So I got numbers going my way there, but I stay away. Let's go to New York, where the Adam Gases are hosting the Buffalo Bills. Bills opened up as 13-point favorites. It's down to 10. We got it at 12, but this number's like this. It's a pinball. I don't know where it's going. I don't know. But double digits in the NFL, I can't do it. I can't stomach it. And I almost tried to find some reasons to play the Jets here. I lean Jets here just because of the double digits. And I'm not as high on the Bills as a lot of people are. Sam Darnold's back. I don't have to have Joe Flacco as my quarterback. That's good. What else could happen here? I dug deep. Greg Williams is the defensive coordinator for the New York Jets. And he's a dirty coach. I mean, he is the architect of Bounty Gate. And, I mean, I watched that game against the Broncos earlier this year when the Broncos were up two scores trying to run the clock out. And this guy's still, like, committing personal fouls. And he wasn't. But he had his players still committing personal fouls against the second-string quarterback of the Denver Broncos. So, I mean, he's a dirty guy. Josh Allen's a guy that likes to, you know, run around. I don't think Josh protects himself enough when he's, you know, out scrambling and running for first downs. I'd like to see some more slides. I'd like to see him protect himself a little bit more. And he doesn't. So he's going to be exposed. I think those Jets defensive players are going to be coached up to hurt Josh Allen this week. And for that reason only, I think that the Jets have a real, not that reason only. That's a little too far. But that's a definite big factor why I lean Jets here. Stay off it, though. Let's go out to L.A. Rams hosting the Bears. And again, I just think we have a lot of groupthink about the Bears here. And I fully admit, I fall into it. I don't think the Bears are good. I think that they have a lot of fraudulent wins this year. A lot of close wins. A lot of, you know bad wins. I don't know. I mean, they're all good wins. But I just think they have bad wins. I'm not that impressed with the Bears. The Rams would be winning the NFC East right now because they're 4-0 against the NFC East. So the Rams don't have good wins either. So I stay away. I would lean Bears here. I'm starting to turn the corner on the Bears. And I'm going to look for some value in the next few weeks in the Bears to get this win because I think the groupthink is in. And Big Dick Nick, maybe he'll get the job done out in L.A. I don't know. I just look for the Bears to keep this within 6. Open up at 7, down to 6. Not too much more about that. Let's go out to Foxborough, where I have a lot to say about this game. Niners opened up as 5-point favorites, down to 2-point favorites. 52% of the bets, 74% of the money on the Pats, and I'm with that sharp money. I'm with that 74% money on the Pats. I think the Pats had, this is an ultimate buy low spot on the Pats. So I like that up-down theory here, where the Niners coming off a big win at home against the Rams. Pats, bad loss against the Broncos. Terrible loss against the Broncos. They look terrible. They look lost. They look turnover prone, things like that. I like Belichick this week. Actually, in the full week of practice, getting the game plan against Jimmy G. I mean, I think that Pat's coaching staff will have a lot to do with, like, they know Jimmy. He was theirs before. So I think they know his tendencies a little bit better than, you know, most. But I just can't get over that performance last week by the Patriots. I can't stomach betting them here and laying 2 points. I mean, the Patriots last week had to have Julian Edelman throw 2 passes, guys. He threw 2 passes. It wasn't a trick play. Like, they did it once. They had to do it again. Like, that's terrible. And last week, the Broncos kicked 6 field goals on the backs of Drew Lock completing 10 passes to Broncos players and 2 passes to Patriots players. So that's just, I don't know. I lean Pats here. If you take the Pats here, I'm all with you. But it was definitely the number 6 pick. It was a coin flip to get that off the board. So good on you if you go Pats. Let's get into the dudes. And we're going to go to the Battle of Ohio here, where you have the Cincinnati Bengals hosting the Cleveland Browns. And I have the Cleveland Browns laying only 3 points. I think it's a great buy-low spot on the Browns. They had a bad performance with the Steelers last week. It's very tangible. Baker Mayfield, not a great quarterback, in my opinion. But he performs, you know, he's performable. He's decent against defenses that won't pressure him. And he is awful against defenses that do pressure him. So he runs into a spot here where the Bengals will not pressure him. They're unable to pressure the quarterback. I think they have like 7 sacks on the season. Definitely in the bottom, you know, third of the league in defensive performance. And like really, like we're dealing with like a very neutral field here. Not a lot of travel for the Browns. You know, I don't know if they take a bus. I don't know how you get from Cleveland to Cincinnati. I'm sure they have a private jet that's like a 30-minute flight. But not a huge travel deal for the Browns here. And you have a 4-win team going against a 1-win team in week 7 of the NFL, and like, I don't know if like laying 3 here is like the worst thing in the world. I'm sure in most cases here you lay a lot more than that. So I go Browns. I look for Myles Garrett to get to Joe Burrow. I thought the Colts would get to Burrow last week. I look for Myles Garrett to make Joe Burrow want to take his own helmet off and throw it at his head coach and say, "Can you give me some offensive line?" Oh boy. This is a late action play for me here. We go down to Denver, where the Denver Broncos are hosting the Kansas City Chiefs. I kind of take this as value against you guys. I don't know how much research you do, but I know this, that tomorrow when the Broncos kick it off against the Chiefs, it will be 19 degrees with 5 inches of snow. This line we have at 9.5. It's down to 7 now because of the weather. I'm going to talk about Denver weather here real quick. I didn't really realize it until now, but they might have more volatile weather in Denver than we have here in Michigan. It's going to be, they're going to get 10 inches of snow over the next couple of days. It's going to be, have a low of 4 degrees on Monday. And then next Saturday is going to be 61 and sunny. So I mean, that's insanity. That's insane. That's crazy. but let's talk about this. What will happen in a snow game? Okay, so we saw the game plan against the Bills last week for the Chiefs. Very solid game plan. Rainy, it's nasty. We're going to run the ball down your throat. You're going to play deep. That's fine. Let's do that against the Broncos. Broncos have the 5th-best run defense in the league. And I think the Broncos will be coached up here to stop the run, keep this game close. And I like catching the Broncos plus 9.5. I think I'm getting a lot. I'm getting like 3 points of value here. And really, the Denver Broncos like have played some tough games this year. Like, they played tough against Pittsburgh, a 5-point loss. Played tough against Tennessee, a 2-point loss. And they played tough against the Patriots, and they won the game last week. So, give me the Broncos here. Let me catch that 9.5. I don't know if I have a new girlfriend or not, but the Carolina Panthers are just appealing to me, and I'm going 3 weeks in a row with the Panthers here. Catching the 7 points, I'd love to get that 7.5 we opened up at. Well, we get 7 here. I mean, I think these are 2 even teams, the Panthers and the Saints. So I take the 7, and I think the Saints, like, literally, like, are still getting a little bit of a home field boost when, really, that's just a dead dome. I mean, it's the Superdome, but it's a dead dome. So, give me them. You know, we have some late-breaking news here, you know, that, you know, Michael Thomas is not going to play. Emmanuel Sanders has COVID. So, I mean, you know, the weapons on the Saints side are depleted. Teddy Bridgewater, his against the spread numbers are just off the charts. You know, he's 20-5 as a starter, as a dog, and 15-2 as a road dog. So, go Teddy Two Gloves. Go Mike Davis. Give me the Panthers. Give me the Panthers. Give me DJ Moore. Give me some. Game of the week. 5-0 Pittsburgh travels to 5-0 Tennessee. Pittsburgh's catching a point. Open up as 1.5-point favorites. 47% of the bets. 86% of the money on the Tennessee Titans. That big money has moved that game, like, you know, from one side to the other. And that's a big pivot point. I give that credit. I look for a lot of the big money tomorrow, though, to come in on the Steelers. You know, like a lot of these betting groups, you know, they fight over this kind of stuff. And I think one betting group came in early in the week. Another betting group is going to come in later in the week. And I just flat out, I think the Steelers are better. Taylor Lewan out for the Tennessee Titans this week. Definitely a top five lineman in the league. And I think that's a big deal. I saw that happen last week. And immediately my mind went, who did Tennessee play next week? You know, let's see what's going on. Really, I mean, Tennessee's wins this year, you know, I mean, they have close wins against Denver, Jacksonville, Minnesota, and Houston. Denver has two wins. Jacksonville has one win. Minnesota has one win. Houston has one win. And literally, Houston should have won that game last week. So I look for some money to come in on the Steelers next tomorrow morning. And give me the Steelers here. I think that the Steelers will be able to control this game. A lot of offensive weapons that I like over there on the Steelers. Let's go out to, oh boy, Washington, D.C., our nation's capital. Oh. You know, if you're dying of thirst and you're like on an episode of Survivor alone and, you know, you had to walk 15 minutes and you look down over the horizon and you see this clear, crisp water, you're dying of thirst. You'd run down to that water. You'd dig your knees into the dirt. Your knees would be all dirty. And you'd just shove your face right into that water. And that's what I've done with the Cowboys the last couple weeks. And both times I've shoved my face in the water. A snake has bit me right in the nose. I didn't even see the snake. You know, this week, I just think the Cowboys have to win. And last week's game was not pretty. And the Cowboys are on a short week going to Washington. This game opened up as the Cowboys laying 3. They're down to a pick'em. Actually out there, like, getting a point by now, guys. I don't know. I just think, you know, we got another full week of practice with Andy Dalton. I don't think Dalton's that bad. I love the pretty offensive weapons, that clear, crisp water that the Cowboys have on their side. And I look at the Washington side, and I don't see much. I don't like much with what they have going on. I mean, I think they're playing Kyle Allen to try and make sure they tank for Trevor Lawrence. I think they're trying to lose games in a way. I mean, that two-point conversion against the Giants last week, I mean, you had a chance to win the game. Yeah, sure, but go to overtime and try and win the game. I don't know. Vegas isn't scared of this game. They want you to take the Cowboys, and I'm going to put my face in the water one more time for Big D. How about them Cowboys? All right, guys. I'll see you next week.